Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Human Law Hangover question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentation, Human Law Hangover. Recorded on the 23rd of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, so here we are. We're on the subject of the Human Law Hangover still, Q&A, but this is really all three parts of the discussion that led us to the hangover. So we're talking the questions that we're answering about this hangover, but also about the law-related attitudes and emotions and also the human law comparison. Now, the only trouble is we've got like 70 or 80 questions, and as I said, a lot of them are quite detailed questions, and so I'm probably only going to get to be able to answer three or four different people's questions as a result of that. Does that make sense? And we'll have to leave the rest for our studio work. Okay. Now, Paige, where are you at the moment? Over there. So if we could have Mike with Paige. And then it'll be Nikki straight after Nikki, so just in front of you, Paige. But I want to do both of your questions, Paige. So sure. We start with question one.
Is the desire to engage and live in harmony with the self-responsibility principle the key to exposing and deconstructing all my hangover beliefs and emotions? Would that be an economical way of developing and using my will, rather than attempting to intellectually identify each erroneous belief and then feel about it?
Interesting question. And you're dead right, actually, with regard to the question. So what we're basically saying and asking in this question is there a fast way for me to, like, when I looked at all of those hangover beliefs and all of those comparisons and everything, and we've only done a few comparisons, haven't we? It's not like we've done a lot of them. Man, there's so many emotions I have. I don't know where to start is the basic issue we have, right? We don't know what to do about these emotions and we don't know where to start. Now, can you see, though, if we were humble, we would feel any of these emotions anyway. But self-responsibility is an interesting principle as to how it affects our desire to address these things. So you remember the definition of self-responsibility was all about the desire. So we need to write the word desire down. And it starts with desire. And it was desire for a number of things, wasn't it? It was desire for self-awareness, for love, for truth, and for living in harmony with the principles of love and truth, which obviously are injected into all of God's principles. And then it was also about desiring to actually express yourself. So expressing yourself is about actions, isn't it? Taking actions in harmony with love and truth as well, wasn't it? It was about and acting in harmony in regard to looking at and examining, but also working through the issues of desires that are in and out of harmony with that, emotions that are in and out of harmony with that, thoughts that are in or out of harmony with that, and so forth. So the self-responsibility is all about this, having this desire to do that, which is not about doing it perfectly, actually. It's about just having the desire to do it. Right, because we all need to come to understand at some point that we're not perfect yet, and we won't be until we're at one with God. So at this stage, we've got to work towards that, and the only way we can work towards it is, as you'll learn in a couple of days' time as well, is this aspect of desire, which is a big part of the self-responsibility principle. So what Paige is really asking is, if I do that, will I naturally be able to go through the emotions that come up as a result? Well, no, there's probably one more thing you need, isn't there? And that is that quality of, isn't there? Now remember from our previous discussions the definition of humility. Can you remember that? Which is the desire to feel and experience
pain and
well, it's basically all of our emotions, pleasure or pain, isn't it? But the desire to feel and experience all of them, and to work your way through them, right? And now, if you experience the painful ones, they'll go away. If you experience the pleasurable ones, they'll go away. But at the end of the day, none of them will be inside you. And after a while, you'll only have pleasurable ones, and the painful ones will have been gone. That's the basic principle of humility, isn't it? So if you add humility to the self-responsible principle, there is a high likelihood you will actually deal with all of your human law hangover. But if you're not humble, or you don't have a desire, you will not. And it's guaranteed you will not. Yep. Now, God still works with that even. So God's still going, okay, you've decided that you don't want desire, so let's cross that off the list as to what's available to you. Right? And you've decided that you're not going to be humble, so I'm going to cross that off. And he's still going to do some more things for you. He's going to use the compensatory parts of the principles to actually force the will into still recognizing this problem sooner or later. You follow? But it's just going to be a very long-winded and painful process for you if you do that. Does that make sense? The reality is, if you engage desire with humility, you will actually find that you'll progress very rapidly. But if you resist one of those two things, resist desire, resist humility, which is a very important part of this process, if you resist those two things, the only thing you have left is to be beaten around by the law. That's the only thing you have left. And eventually the pain will be too much for you to handle, and you'll end up having a cry anyway. You will. Because once the pain gets too much to handle, you'll have a cry. And this will happen. And let's say you let bits and drabs and drips of it out on earth. You get to the spirit world, you'll end up in a place where you're going to have to cry a lot, because you'll feel like crying a lot there. That's where you end up, right? Now, so even if we resist desire, and even if we resist humility, and do not desire to work through these issues while on earth, there's still hope for us, because the redemptive principles that are involved with regard to the compensation and self-responsibility, and God is causing our redemption even though we're resistive to that process. So basically what we're saying when we're resistive to the process is, God, we're basically saying, I don't want to get better, I want to stay in pain. It's really what we're saying. And God's going, sooner or later you're going to get better. Sooner or later I'm going to get you happy. Sooner or later. You know, that's what God's saying. Sooner or later I'm going to help you be happy. My laws do that for you. Right? Now, isn't that really nice, like, of God to do that, even though we're all with this resistance and so forth? So that's something to bear in mind, but you are dead right. Desire obviously shouldn't be crossed out on our list. It should be something we engage. And humility is something we also need to engage if we're truly going to deal with these problems that we've identified in the hangover. Yeah. Can you ask your second question?
Sure. It's slightly different the way I've written it here, but...
No worries. I like the way you've written it here. But go on. We'll see how you've written it.
Is the reason I'm not aware of loving rewards, assuming that I am doing some loving things, due to the fact that I choose to ignore or deny the loving correction and penalties when I disobey God's principles and laws, i.e. being shut down to penalty automatically shuts me down to feel and recognising any rewards, which then may build my faith in God's goodness?
Yeah, it's an interesting question you've asked, Paige, isn't it? You're basically saying, once I get shut down to the concept of penalty, I'm also starting to get shut down to the concept of reward. So in other words, once I'm shut down to the compensatory issues or principles that we raise after the lunch period that we have soon, you're basically saying that if I get shut down to one side of that equation, I'm automatically shutting down to the other side of the equation. Now, this causes me to not actually measure the rewards that come from obedience. all I'm trying to do then is just like avoid the consequences of disobedience. And I'm not focused on doing a good thing and what the potential rewards of doing that good thing would be. Of course, from God's perspective, doing the good thing is not enough. You must feel like doing the good thing for there to be a reward, right? But let's assume that if we feel like doing the good thing, there's a reward, and we feel like doing the bad thing, there's a penalty, which is the way it works with God. Can you see that if I shut down the concept of penalties based upon feelings, I'm now going to only be thinking penalties are based upon actions? And therefore, I also shut down the possibility of rewards being based upon feelings. Right? So I start living this life where I actually believe that doing the right thing ends up with rewards, and doing the wrong thing is going to end up in penalties. Or avoid doing the wrong thing, I'm going to have no penalties. That's what I think. But unfortunately, that's not how God's laws work. It's having a feeling of wanting to do the right thing that produces the rewards, even if it was impossible for you to do the right thing in the end. That's still going to give the reward as if you did it. So there are times like that where you're prevented by external forces from doing the right thing. Not from your use of your will or desire, but other things control you. So for example, a great example is this, is a guy chooses to not go to war. Is he doing the right thing? Yes, he is, right? He's choosing not go to war. He's doing the right thing. But the penalty that the humans put upon him is they either put him in jail or they, you know, in the Second World War, what happened is that they would tar and feather you and they'd do all sorts of different things to you to ridicule you. And in some cases, they used to have punishment fields on the battlefield where they would put the people who didn't go to war in the battle without any weapon or anything like that, because obviously those people refused to carry them, and usually they'd get shot or harmed that way or whatever. So there's a lot of things that the world will do to you, but from God's perspective, that person wanted to do the right thing, but they're still there. They were forced to be there, but he didn't want to be there, and also he's still not willing to do anything about shooting another person or even taking up the arms. And as a result, he's rewarded as if he did do it, right? And this is the thing, is that we need to see that actually God rewards the desire. Because remember, the self-responsibility principle is about desire. So God rewards desire, not the outcome. Now, for most people, we don't understand that yet. We're still thinking that, you know, you've got to actually achieve the outcome before God will reward it. But that's not the way it is. God rewards the desire. Now, how does this relate then to addressing our hangover? Well, humans don't reward the desire. They only punish the negative outcome, the negative action. They don't reward a positive desire, and they don't even punish the negative desire. So God's law operates on the desire, the intention. Human law operates on the outcome. And this causes us to believe that God doesn't measure our intention. You see? And the problem with not seeing that God measures our intention is that we then start acting like all we have to do is act rather than change our feelings. So you can see that in answer to your question, yes, one of the reasons why we're not aware, once we turn off the concept of a loving reward, and I'm going even further and suggesting once you turn off the concept that there's a loving reward based upon a loving desire, once you turn off that concept, now you're just driven by action. And this is why many of you remain addicted to your facade, because you think, if I take the action, that's all that I need to do, right? I don't have to change my feeling, my attitude. Right? And God's going, sorry. It's the attitude that drives the action. So God wants the cause of the action to be addressed, which is the attitude. And God also rewards an attitude that's in harmony with love, even if you couldn't take the action for some external reason. So this is where we need to really understand that, yes, if we don't understand those principles with regard to self-responsibility and also don't understand how much the human law hangover is affecting this thing that we have now, which is basically all I have to do is act and everything will be okay, right? And that's not okay from God's perspective. All you need to do is change your attitude and everything will be okay. Right? But as you know, changing your attitude is more difficult than changing your action. And that's why many of you change your action without changing your attitude. But there's a pointlessness to that, isn't there? God's laws are still trying to address your attitude, not your action. Because God's laws know and measure your attitude, and therefore God knows that you haven't actually changed on that matter. Yeah. So that's a very powerful thing to remember. And we'll talk more about that in the compensatory principles. But that two good, really nice questions there. Can we come forward to Nikki? Your question number one, two, and five, Nikki. So
if current human laws are not ultimately in harmony with God's laws, but assist in the governance of humans in our current condition, will God still support those laws?
Well, God only supports laws that are in harmony with his principles. But God, remember, God's laws govern intention. Mm-hmm. So if the intention of the human law is to assist the governance of humans in a bad condition,
right,
that intention will be rewarded. Yeah. Yep. Even if the law itself is out of harmony,
yep,
with God's principles, because the intention is in harmony with God's principles.
Yep, that makes
sense.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
So if a human lawmaker creates a law and his intention is to actually benefit society, then he will not be penalized,
yep,
except for the bits and pieces that he had out of harmony law. But also he'll be rewarded for the fact that he had an intention, yeah, that was actually positive from God's perspective,
wow,
even though the law was negative.
Yeah.
And because God's laws measure intention or desire has a higher principle than measuring the will,
yeah,
therefore the intention is going to be measured and rewarded far more than the fact that he created a law out of harmony, love will be penalized.
That's amazing. That is amazing.
Yeah. So this is the beauty of understanding how God rewards and penalizes issues,
yeah,
is we examine the intention, the desire, which is really an intention, isn't it? It's a future-based, faith-based thing of wanting to achieve something in the future, and that's what God is rewarding.
Yeah.
So if you consider that from a lawmaker's perspective, you need to be less worried about the law you're creating and whether that's in harmony or out of harmony than you do about your intention of what you're trying to achieve with the law.
Mm.
Now, if you're trying to achieve a selfish goal or you're trying to achieve some kind of system that is obviously unloving to other people or not equal, then obviously now your intention is bad,
yeah,
and if the law will probably be bad as well, now you've got a double problem, haven't you?
Yeah.
Given the fact that God penalizes the desire more than he penalizes,
yeah,
the action. So can you see the necessity of seeing everything from the point of view of,
yeah,
desire? Yeah, good question, hey? Mm. Can you read your next one for me?
Yeah. As human lawmakers strongly believe that penalties and punishments are necessary to maintain order, has this attitude predominantly come from the priesthood and their fear-mongering attitudes to get others to conform to their false beliefs about God?
Well, no, it hasn't predominantly come from the priesthood or the religious leaders, if you could call them that, of any faith. It's predominantly come from our parents. You see, no religion on this planet exists without your predisposition from a parental perspective, forcing your predisposition to believe that particular thing. So the reality is adult, like adult priests or people in power of any kind, but usually religious power, anybody in religious power, like a priest, obviously has been affected from his own childhood to believe what he believes. But also, you will not do what he says unless you, from childhood, have been taught to believe what
he
believes. Now, this is the power of religion, religious beliefs. Particularly when they're false, they are terribly, they're terribly negative with regard to that. Because what we're basically doing from a very young age is we're predisposing the child to believe in certain things, which then makes them susceptible to adult-based religious belief systems that they would not have normally have been susceptible to if the parent had never taught them certain things. Now, that's whether the parent was religious or not. So, for example, let's say the parent teaches the child that it's right to punish the child violently. Now, almost every parent teaches a child this at some point, you know. They get so frustrated and so upset, usually with the lack of control, that eventually they teach the child. So now the child feels that punishment is a form of love. Now, that child will grow up believing that any religious system that teaches that a punishment is a form of love is right. They're going to believe that. Here's another example. Let's say the child was taught that if he sacrifices himself for the sake of other people, then that's a loving thing to do, particularly if he sacrifices himself for his parents. That's a loving thing to do. As an adult, he's now open to be taught that if he sacrifices himself for God, that's a loving thing to do. You see?
I've got that one. So.
Yeah. So there's a predisposition created in childhood from the first lawmakers in your life, which are your parents, that now open you to whatever a religious belief system believes. Interestingly, too, the religious belief system wouldn't even exist on the planet unless there was the predisposition.
Yeah.
So no religion would ever teach that sacrifice is a religious faith-based issue if in their childhood every person on earth was taught love does not sacrifice.
Yeah.
Can you see that?
Yeah.
So it's very important to not blame the result of the parent's behavior with the child upon the system that now exists as adults. Does that make sense? Because we're blaming the effect. The actual cause is the childhood belief systems created by the parents and their interactions with the child.
Okay.
Good day. Let's go to five.
Yeah, this is just a bit of a reflection I had.
It's a very good reflection. Let's read it out.
Okay. I have a feeling that in order to implement God's laws on earth, the earth could be sectioned by law, not country borders like it is now. So as people learn and develop their condition in an area of the earth that encourages that development, they could then move to a different location on earth to learn more complex and advanced lessons as governed by their improved soul condition. How do you feel about this?
Well, how does everyone feel about that idea? It's a pretty amazing idea, isn't it? Now, this is the thing, the beauty of discussing these human law hangovers and so forth, is you start now seeing the problem. Now, whenever you start seeing a problem, you now are open to discovering solutions to it. You follow?
Yep.
So this is one of the potential solutions, is it not, to this problem? And the beauty of this kind of thinking is that once we understand the problem, we can come up with many different solutions and then choose the best solution. So, for example, in a country itself, within a country, you could section off parts of the country that these are the people who have gone through this lesson. They live there. Now, that would mean people moving around, not being so stuck about what's home and what's not home and all these other things, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Which would require some maybe rejigging in our thought-based systems. Yeah. But But the reality is there are many ways to actually address this problem. Many ways that are out logical and would in some cases be relatively easy to actually put into place. I'm not saying your example is relatively easy to put in place. I'm just saying there are many solutions. So what I would encourage many of you to do when you're thinking about this hangover and thinking about the effects, think, and then it causes you to think about the problems, which is a lot to do with desire, isn't it, again?
Yeah.
It's about self-responsibility. Can you see that?
Yeah.
So a lot of these problems relating to our hangover is all about, am I wanting to take self-responsibility or not?
Yeah.
How do I create a system of governance on earth, given the current levels of self-responsibility, that rewards self-responsibility in the populace and then allow for the development of self-responsibility?
Yeah.
Now, can you see that if people got together and had these discussions, you could come up with many potential solutions to this problem?
Yeah.
Right? And this is what I would encourage you guys to do as a part of your discussions. You see, many times you talk about, oh, last week I was doing this and this week I'm doing that. And can you see that many of those kind of discussions are pretty like, well, they're pretty banal, you know, like, are they like banal? Banal is probably the right way of pronouncing that word. And why are they so banal? It's because we're not thinking out of the box we're living in. And hopefully what this week will help you do is to start thinking out of the box you're living in and start realizing that there are actually practical solutions that humans can enact and engage that can solve these problems.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was also feeling that if that, like, let's say there are sections, you know, like in different countries where, you know, to learn a lesson, you go there first.
Yeah.
Like that almost... like motivate and encourage those people in a lower condition of love to kind of go through those lessons and go through, like, let's say, repentance processes to then go to a different part of the earth to then learn more lessons and more, you know,
like, you know,
it's like constant. It's like we're going from one place to the other, to the other, to the other, just to keep growing in love. And it's like a big motivational thing, isn't it?
And then none of us would all be attached also to this concept of my country, my nationality, my way of life, my culture, my race, my family, my religion, my...
Yeah.
Can you see straight away it blocks a lot of those paradigms as well that have forced us into a certain way of thinking.
Straight away.
So, yeah, there's, as I said, it's one solution that does provide many potential benefits. Now, of course, if it's ever done, it will depend upon the desire of collective humanity, you see.
Yep.
But what did we learn a few days ago with the Berlin Wall coming down? It started with just a few people, right, having an idea and a concept that's in harmony with love. And how rapidly did the outcome happen? Very rapidly. So, see, this is the thing, is we don't realize that when we engage God's principles and laws, there's a potential for rapid change on the earth where everybody goes, wow, you know, I don't see many problems with that idea.
Yeah.
And they start working with the idea, and it requires just a few brave souls to actually engage those processes, doesn't it?
Yeah. And you were saying that when somebody does that, then you've got the celestial spirits who are ready to then help implement all of that if it's all in harmony with God's laws.
Don't you think there's millions of celestial spirits who want to help certain things change on earth, but they've got no vehicle to use because most of us are not, we're already out of harmony with the principles that they can work with. But as soon as some of us get into harmony with the principles they can work with, what do you think is going to happen? Bang, 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 a lot of things are going to fall into place with their, you know, with their help and their projections of people and whatever else. A lot of things will fall into place as a result. And we, at this stage, because that's not the world we're used to, we sort of go, oh, that's not really possible, so I'm not going to try.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we have a tendency to do. Yeah.
Cheers, bro. Thanks.
No worries. So can we go to Rachel? Thank you. Where are you, Rachel? Yep, thank you. Can we have your question? Yeah, you're just that single question of yours on human law hangover.
I don't have it in front of me, but and I thought I could make it more succinct as well.
Thought it was pretty good.
Okay.
Yeah, but far away.
So I don't have it in front of me, but...
Do you want me to read it out?
Yes, please.
Is it a requirement of God's law to obey human laws, even if it limits your free will? but it is not unloving to others. For example, when you're riding a bike over a bridge, get off the bike because you might run over somebody else who's walking over the bridge, that kind of thing. Does that make sense to everyone? And this is, I feel, a bit of a misunderstanding on your part, Rachel, but I feel the same misunderstanding in most people. Can something that limits your free will really be a limitation of your free will when it provides a benefit to other people's freedom? Can you see that anything, any law that's created, and you can see with God's laws, God has all these laws, you could claim, couldn't you, looking at all these principles you've looked at already, you could almost claim that God's not giving us free will, couldn't you? But no, you still have free will. And God just provides limitations of how that will is used, because you could use your will in an unloving way, which then affects millions of people unlovingly. So can you then say, I should have my free will to act unlovingly? No. God's basically saying, you've got free will, but I'm giving you free will to act lovingly. Now, in amongst lovingly, you've got an infinite amount of possibilities of what you can do in amongst lovingly. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But we often see an unloving action that we're taking, and we justify the unloving action, and we say, now my will's being limited. I'll give you an example of this. At home, we've got tents, right? And myself and Mary live in a tent, and there's one other tent for visitors that come. And one time we had a visitor come, and we told her that one of the laws that we've made for the tent is to not burn candles in the tent. Now, she spent 3 days just in a rage about that before we sent her home. She felt her free will was being limited. Do you know why I asked her not to burn candles in the tent? Because the tent's made of cotton, and if it gets a flame on it, it's down to the ground with her in it. So I made the law for a loving reason. She decided that I was impacting upon her free will, and that she was so upset about it, we actually had to finish up asking her to leave. That's how upset about it she was, just being able to burn a candle in a tent. Now, that's an illustration of how we often want to believe that our free will is being limited, but we don't understand the concept of free will. And the concept of free will is God will not limit your will unless you're unloving. Then he's going to limit your will. And in fact, all of his laws limit your will, limit the expression of it, the more unloving you become.
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
If it's not unloving...
So in other words, if it's loving...
Yeah, if it's loving, and if it's the middle of the night and there's nobody around and you speed or something,
mm-hmm.
and
isn't it still unloving to you?
If you're not going,
what
to
if an animal comes out, you run into it, you're killed.
Yeah, that's true.
Isn't it still unloving to you?
Yeah, I wonder more if being born on the planet and assuming into a country with specific laws. Is it important that we follow those laws sort of no matter what, even if some of them are unjust? Or?
Well, this is the problem, is that many of us have a huge amount of hangover and we believe things are unjust when they're actually just.
Mm.
And this is where our personal assessment needs to be reappraised. This is what I'm suggesting. Many of you believe that your will is being limited when somebody's trying to limit you from doing something wrong. And that's not God's assessment. Under God's assessment, your will's not being limited anymore. Right? That's a correction of the unloving use of your will from God's perspective. But so we've got to be very careful about how we appraise things. And most of us have a lot of anger about our childhood experience, which we're then imposing. And we're saying they control my will. They control my will. When the reality is they weren't controlling your loving expression of your will. They were trying to correct the unloving expression of your will, right? Which is exactly what God's trying to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So in that way, they are completely in harmony with God's desires. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. So it's a very important thing, distinction to make, that particular distinction. Now, our last question, which I've got a bit of time for, is Pete Litton Indigenous, down the front here. Under law-related attitudes and emotions.
Can you share what happens in our soul when we are obeying the law through fear compared to desire?
Good question. The answer to that question is it's impossible to obey one of God's laws through fear. By having fear as the motivator to obey the law, you are automatically disobeying the law. Does everyone get that? By having fear as a motivation to obey the law, from God's perspective, you are automatically disobeying the law. From God's perspective, the only time you actually obey one of God's laws is when you have a desire to obey the law. Interesting, huh?
So our whole upbringing at schools and, you know, with our parents, where
that's a huge hangover, isn't it, from that childhood experience? Because what do our parents tell us? Fear is a good thing. Yeah. It helps you obey.
And you have to.
Yeah, yeah. And what God's saying is, no, the fear is not a good reason for obedience. And in fact, if you are acting out of fear and obeying one of God's laws, from God's perspective, you are not obeying that law.
Yeah.
You are just not obeying it, right? So give up this facade driven by fear and start working on the desire to actually do it, you know, to actually obey because your heart tells you to obey. That's the lesson there, isn't it?
Totally.
Yeah. Now, obviously, the effect is a bit different if you obey the law through fear or you don't obey it at all. So in other words, if you obey the law through fear, the effect no longer happens. Right, so let's say, you know, the unloving effect no longer happens.
You didn't take the action of actually going through with...
Yeah, so let's say one of God's laws is treat each other equally, as equal. You don't feel like doing that, and you feel afraid that if you don't, you're going to get punished. And so when the race comes along that you're not that keen on... Right, someone who's ripped you off in the past and they've been of that race, you know, maybe there's been five people who've ripped you off and they've all been of that race, and then you're going to have some issues to address there, aren't you? But you still go, I say, no, God's saying treat him equally. No worries, I'll treat him equally. But my feeling inside of me is,
just
no, I know I don't want to treat him equally, but I'll treat him equally. So you treat him equally. At least you're not, there's not going to be a terrible thing occur to that person because you've restrained your behavior. Isn't that true? But the emotion coming out of you and entering the person is identical, and that has an effect on him. So there's still consequences that are negative by you not addressing the fact that you don't have a desire.
So when we're saying we're a law-abiding citizens,
mm-hmm.
but we're just simply terrified.
Exactly. Or that we just have learnt to obey the law because we, you know, we won't get away with it otherwise, then we're out of harmony with obedience from God's perspective. Yeah. All right? Very important thing. Very important thing to understand. Now, I haven't got time to discuss that further, unfortunately, but it's something that we will talk about more when it comes to compensation. I can't discuss it further. I'm already over time. So very interesting that what that raises, isn't it, in terms of our belief systems and what we're thinking of. We need to understand what's really going on there. And so I thought it was just a great question for that. Now, guys, as you can imagine, we've got lots of those kind of questions. So, you know, it should be quite an interesting discussion when we get to answering them in the studio. When we come around to that point, which hopefully will be sometime during the new year. Well, that's the end of our Q&A on the Human Law Hangover. We will have, if we can come back, our next discussion is this, that session, compensation principles. And that'll be the last of our order-based principles, a very essential principle to understand so that you understand desire, will and redemption. So we need to understand the compensation principles. And if we can come back at 5 to 2, is that right? That's 30 minutes from now. And we'll get started on our compensation principles. Thanks, guys. Thank you.